This is a cartoon appeared in a French journal. I show this cartoon because for probably 50 years, the gravitational waves were a kind of exoteric matter for at least for the general public. And now there is some humor about the fact that there is the French president talking with some ministers and saying that there is the probably the effect of a hole in the budget and a hole in the health insurance will maybe make gravitational wave in 2017. From a kind of exoteric matter, these gravitational waves now are a kind of pop topic. This is the outline of my presentation. I will briefly show the news. Then I will make a step backward. I will discuss the nature of the gravitational waves. Then I will talk about the quest for gravitational waves, the instruments, LIGO and Virgo, the event, what has been called GW150914, the date of the event, and some summary and outlook. This is the paper, appeared on a physical review letter on February 11, observation of gravitational wave from a binary black hole merger. It's a paper signed by 1,004 persons from the LIGO scientific collaboration, Virgo scientific collaboration. Roughly 800 from LIGO and 200 for Virgo. It's a huge collaboration. If you want, you can download the paper at this address, and there are also 12 companion papers discussing several aspects of the discovery. This is the event. The event has been seen September 14, 11:51 Central European Time, and has been seen first on the observatory of Livingston in Louisiana, and 7 milliseconds after on the observatory of Hanford west coast in the Washington state. The event lasted for a fraction of a second, 200 milliseconds, is what we call a chirp, a signal increasing in frequency and amplitude with time. And it is an event created by the merging of two black holes. This is a simulation made by with the general relativity code. And we see the two black holes orbiting one around the other, and you see the gravitational lensing of the stars behind the holes. And you see the merging of the two black holes, and a single black hole is formed by the coalescence of the two black holes. So that's the event. So a merging of two black holes at 1 billion, 3 million light years from the Earth, which gave this signal lasted by for 200 milliseconds. So before to discuss a little bit more in detail the event, let me speak about, first of all, let me say that this is the first direct detection of gravitational waves, and this is the first observation of a merger of two black holes. That's the two main aspects of this discovery. So before entering in the details of the discovery, let me speak a little bit about the general framework. The discovery has been made by these two observatories, LIGO Livingston and LIGO Hanford, and these two observatories are part of the network, larger network, which includes also Virgo and GEO-600. GEO-600 is in a state which is not able to see the event because the sensitivity is not enough. Virgo is still under an upgrade phase. I will come back on this later. There are other observatories which are planned and also in a phase of integration. So we are part of the Virgo collaboration. Virgo collaboration is operating one of the interferometers of the network. It's a 3 kilometer interferometer near Pisa, and the Virgo collaboration is formed by 5 European countries and 200 physicists and engineers. My lab, the AstroParticle and Cosmology in Paris, the AstroParticle and Cosmology lab, is one of the 19 lab of the Virgo collaboration. So now, let me discuss the nature of the gravitational wave first. So everything starts with, you know, that the story of the gravitation starts with Newton. Newton was the first who understood the nature of the gravitational. He understood that the apple which falls and the moon which orbits around the Earth have the same move by the same force, which is the gravitation. This the law, the Newton's law of universal gravitation, had enormous success until half of 19th century, where there was the first problems. And the most important one was the precession of the perihelion of Mercury, which was not fully understood in the framework of the Newton law. And in 1905, Einstein came and he published the special relativity theory, where he understood, I mean, there is a speed limit, a universal speed limit in the propagation of the interaction, which is the speed of light. In 1915, Einstein published the general relativity theory, which is a theory which addresses also the problem of the gravitation, and in particular, he published these famous equations, which are the Einstein's general relativity equation, where he puts in relation the space-time geometry. This quantity is a quantity which is which contains the space-time geometry with the energy matter content in the universe. So the space-time geometry tells the energy matter how to move, and this energy matter determines the space-time geometry. These equations are able to explain the gravity in terms of a curvature of the space-time. The Earth orbit around the Sun is given by the fact the space is curved around the Sun. And so the Earth falls in a curved space-time. The Earth follows the straightest path in a curved space-time. This is a static solution of the Einstein's equation. But the Einstein's equation predict also the gravitational waves. The gravitational waves are the equivalent of the electromagnetic wave for the electromagnetism. They are a perturbation of the space-time metric, which propagate the speed of light, and they carry a vibration of the space-time. They carry the gravity. The gravity is the geometry of the space-time. So they propagate at the speed of light. They are transverse, like the electromagnetic wave. They have two polarization at 45 degrees. And they are generated by acceleration of masses. the electromagnetic waves are generated by the acceleration charges. So there is a real analogy between electromagnetic waves and gravitational waves. In this plot, you see the effect of the passing of a gravitational wave through the slide on a system of a ring of free masses. So if you have some free masses, for example, masses floating in space, and the gravitational wave passes, the gravitational wave stretches the space in asymmetric direction. So there is in one direction there is an elongation, and in another direction the space is shortened. And this effect is very small, as we will see in the following. And it's so small that the only source able to produce gravitational waves, which are detectable by an instrument, are astrophysical events, like the coalescence of two black holes, a neutron star, or the explosion of a star. So in this animation, you see, for example, the two black holes orbiting one around each other. So what happens is that the two black holes, the two masses, they emit gravitational waves and they lose energy. And this energy loss makes the two objects to be closer and closer. And this phenomenon is called coalescence. And the gravitational waves increase in frequency and in amplitude. And at some point, the two black holes, they become a single black hole, and there is no more emission of gravitational waves. So the gravitational waves are emitted by acceleration of masses, and in particular by the acceleration of asymmetric distribution of masses. So the gravitational waves, they travel in the universe, and they reach the Earth, and you see what happens when they cross the Earth. The effect is vastly exaggerated, as is written here. And so they stretch the space-time, and we can see it again. There is the effect is increases in amplitude and in frequency, and until the coalescence of the two stars. So the effect is vastly exaggerated, because what we have seen is something of the order of 10 to the minus 18 meters on a length of 3 kilometers. So 10 to the minus 18 meters is very small compared to everything, and is roughly a thousandth of the dimensions of the nucleus of the atom. So we want to measure 10 to the minus 18 meters over a few kilometers. That's the challenge. So that's the reason why the detection of the gravitational waves have taken so long, because it's very difficult to detect 10 to minus, to measure 10 to minus 18 meters. The quest of the gravitational waves started in the 60s. The gravitational waves have been predicted by Einstein in 1916. But for about 40 years, the physicists argued about the physical nature of gravitational waves. They were not sure about the physical nature. They were not sure even if the gravitational waves were carrying energy or not. And in the 60s, Joseph Weber started in the Maryland University, started to build the first gravitational wave detector. It was an aluminum bar, and the idea was that the gravitational wave crossing the bar was exciting the bar at the resonant frequency of the gravitational wave. So he operated this bar for roughly 10 years, but at some point the physicist recognized that the sensitivity of the bars were limited, and also the bar have a limitation. They are only sensitive around the resonance. So physicists started to think about wide band detectors, interferometric detectors. So the idea is that the gravitational wave crosses the detector and stretches the space-time, and so we see a change in the interference with respect to two beams in orthogonal directions. The concept is was elaborated in 1962. The first prototype was in 1971. The sensitivity was around four order magnitudes below what has been obtained recently. And these two persons are two of the key persons of the research in these years, Ray Weiss and Ron Drever. And all this research in the 70s led in the 80s to the proposals for the LIGO and Virgo kilometric detectors. And so let me show a little bit more how a gravitational wave detector works. So you have a light beam. The light beam is split in two parts, and there is a change in the interference which we can detect, we can measure at the output of the interferometer with the photodetector. This is the same animation, but we see the waves, and we can appreciate that the two beams are in with pi. There is a pi difference between the two beams, and when there is a gravitational wave, the phase difference between the two beams changes. This concept was used. I remember that this concept of the Michelson interferometer was used by Michelson and Morley for the first test about to see any difference in the speed propagation of the light. And the Michelson and Morley experiment was a key experiment to demonstrate the non-existence of the ether. And the Michelson Morley experiment has a sensitivity of lambda over 50, over 1,000. Here we have a sensitivity of lambda over 10 to the 12. So it's just to appreciate the difference between the sensitivity obtained by Michelson under 30 years ago and now. So these are the kilometric detectors built around 2000. So the two LIGOs, GEO 600 meters long and Virgo 3 kilometers long. Virgo was built after the idea of Alain Brié in France and Adalberto Giazzotto in Italy, the two founders of the project. And these detectors started to work together in 2007. They signed an agreement to exchange the data and to have a common publication policy. The agreement is the sharing of the data is interesting for at least two reasons. The first is that if you detect an event in three interferometers, you increase the confidence in the detection. But also, if you detect an event in three sites, which are separated by tens of milliseconds, you can make a triangulation of the source. You can detect the position of the source in the sky. We will come back later on this point. So since 2007, the detectors work together. They have been operated with a sensitivity which is already at the level of 10 to the minus 18. This is a strain. This is the Fourier frequency. And you see there is a sensitivity of between 10 to the minus 23, 10 to the minus 22 in strain in the bucket. And you see the Virgo detector in blue was a little bit more sensitive in the low frequency, a little bit less sensitive in the central frequency. And in green and red, you see the sensitivity of the two LIGOs. This was around 2009. And these detectors took a few years of data with no detection. So no detection, a lot of frustration. 50 papers published, but with papers with only upper limit on astrophysical sources. And after that, we decided to upgrade the detector. So they were proposed the Advanced LIGO project and the Advanced Virgo project. You see the sensitivity obtained, measured with initial detectors and the sensitivity of Advanced LIGO, and the sensitivity of Virgo and the sensitivity of Advanced Virgo. So the idea was to increase the sensitivity by a factor of 10, an order of magnitude, which increases the rate of events by a factor of 1,000, because if you increase the sensitivity by a factor of 10, you increase the distance you can detect events by a factor of 10, increase the volume by a factor of 1,000. So one day of Advanced Virgo, Advanced LIGO corresponds to 3 years of Advanced Virgo, Virgo and LIGO. And the first detector operated has been Advanced Virgo, which started the data taking in September 2015. And this is the sensitivity, LIGO, the LIGO initial LIGO sensitivity. This is the sensitivity of Advanced LIGO at the time of the data taking in September, which is a factor of 3 in this region, a little bit more in this region. In blue, you see the design sensitivity. So there is still a factor of 3 between the actual sensitivity and the design sensitivity. And the data taking lasted for 4 months, so from September to January. So let me recall, 40 years of efforts from the 70s to now, but there were indirect evidence of the existence of the existence of gravitational waves. So we were sure that the gravitational wave exists, and this was mainly due to the discovery in 1974 by Alcee Taylor of the binary pulsar 1913+16. It's a binary pulsar P1913+16. And this is a really remarkable plot. Is in the x-axis there are years from 1965 to 2005, so 30 years. And in this y-axis there is the decrease of the orbital period of this system, these two stars system. You see in the solid line the prediction of the general relativity for the decrease of the period, because the period decreases because there is this energy loss by gravitational waves. And the dots are the experimental points. So the Alcee Taylor and Weisberg, they demonstrated indirectly the existence, the effect of the gravitational waves, the energy loss by the gravitational waves, which is responsible for the decrease in the orbital period of this system. And Alcee and Taylor got the Nobel Prize for this discovery in 1993. So gravitational wave, this was a very big motivation for the quest of the gravitational wave direct detection. So let me stress again, this is an indirect detection, indirect observation, because you don't detect directly gravitational waves. Here, you detect the effect of the gravitational wave on a system, the energy loss given by the gravitational waves. And also, it's not possible to discuss this in detail, but in the last, let's say, 20 years, there were enormous progress in the waveform simulations of the waveforms of gravitational waves, and also in the black hole physics. So, to understand the physics of black holes, and also to isolate black holes candidates. So let me discuss before showing again the event. Let me discuss a little bit the interferometers in detail. So, an interferometer for the detection of gravitational waves is composed by a system of free-falling masses, free masses, ideally masses with no interaction with the environment, and a detection system, laser and detector. And this system is affected by tens of different kind of noises, and you want to reduce all these noises below 10 to the minus 18 meters. So these noises are, for example, the seismic noise, the any kind of environmental noise, for example, acoustic noise, the thermal noise, the vibration of the atoms given by the thermal energy, the detection noises, the fact that you are detecting photons. When you count photons, you have shot noise. The laser noise, the laser frequency noise, the laser amplitude noise, all the noises related to the laser source, the electronic noises, the diffuse light, photons escaping from the main beam, hitting something which is not seismically isolated, and coming back in the main beam and contaminating the main beam with some noise. And other noise. So I will discuss some of these noises just to present some features of the detector. So the seismic noise, this is the seismic spectrum, a typical seismic spectrum. Order of magnitude is at 10 Hertz, is something of 10 to the minus 8, 10 to the minus 9 meter per square root of Hertz. What we want is 10 to the minus 18, 10 to the minus 19. So we need to attenuate the seismic noise by several order of magnitude. So what we use to reduce the seismic noise is the pendulum. So a pendulum is a system which is a filter, is a low-pass filter. So above the resonant frequency, the pendulum filters the noise of the suspension. What we have in Virgo, for example, is a system of seven pendula in cascade, so a pendula attached to another pendulum attached to another pendulum, and at the end we have the test mass. So at the end, the test mass has an attenuation factor of 10 to the 14, which is enough to completely kill the seismic noise. So this mass above few Hertz is like a mass floating in the space. So that's for example, the seismic noise. Not only the test mass should be isolated from seismic noise, but also all the optical benches. This is an example of one of the optical benches we have. It's a bench which is under vacuum and which is suspended to a seismic isolator. And you see here, for example, other small suspensions. There are a double system with two pendula, and the two pendula are attached to an inverted pendulum. And all these pendula have also not only horizontal attenuators, but also vertical attenuators, because you have seismic coupling between horizontal and vertical, so you have blades, you have springs. And in this picture, you have the pendulum, the super attenuator, and the bench which is attached to the superattenuator. So any component at different level should be isolated from seismic noise. All the components are in vacuum. There are several reasons to put everything in vacuum. This is the tube. These are the towers where the seismic superattenuators are. So we want to limit the air displacement make noise. They can make acoustic noise. So everything is in vacuum. So one important upgrade between the initial detectors and the advanced detector is that even the photo detectors are now in vacuum. So all the components are in vacuum, at different vacuum levels, but everything is in vacuum. And another very important noise is the thermal noise. So the mirror, the test mass, is something which is at the room temperature, so roughly 300 Kelvin. And so there is some thermal energy, and the thermal energy makes the surface of the mirror vibrating. So this thermal energy can contaminate the sensitivity. So what we do, we use systems with very low losses, very low mechanical losses. And so we want to have all the energy on the resonance, on the resonance of the mechanical system. And if all the energy is on the resonance, in the rest of the spectrum, there is less noise. So we want systems, mirrors, and suspensions with very, very low mechanical losses. You see, for example, an example of the mirrors, and these mirrors are 35 centimeter diameter, and the coating of the mirrors, the coating to produce the reflectivity we want in the mirrors, have a special, they are made with special materials with very low losses. So far we have discussed about seismic noise, thermal noise, which are displacement noise. Noise is contaminating the displacement of the test mass. We want also to increase the signal and to reduce the detection noise. So the scheme of the mic, so interferometer, is changed. The scheme of the actual interferometer is a little bit more complex with respect to the mic, so interferometer. In particular, we have fibrillary cavity in the arms of the interferometer, and the role of the fibrillary cavities is to increase the optical length, the optical path length of the interferometer. So we move from 3 kilometers to 1,000 kilometers of actual path length in the arms. And there are other features in the interferometer. There are other mirrors which are called power recycling mirrors, signal recycling mirrors, which are there to increase the signal with respect, increase the signal to noise ratio of the instrument. And there are fibrillary cavities at the input and the output of the interferometer to clean the beam, clean the input beam and clean the output beam, and to further increase the signal to noise ratio. So we have no time to discuss all the features of the interferometer, but just to show that starting from the Michelson interferometer, the scheme is more complex. So this is the sensitivity of the interferometer. So at low frequency, the sensitivity is still limited by seismic noise, but and also with what we call gravity gradient noise. So the noise made by the change in density below the detector. In the central region is thermal noise, and in the high frequency region is quantum noise, is shot noise. And this is the theoretical sensitivity. So the role of the scientists working in the detector is to reduce all these noises. And this is an example of what have been done between 2003 and 2009 in Virgo. So we started with something very at the level 10 to the minus 12, 13, and we end up with something at the level 2000 of 10 to minus 23. So there is a real work of tuning and increasing the subsystems of the detectors, which last for a few years. The event. So September 14, 2015, it was a Monday at 11:51 Central European Time. So the event is this one. This is in this plot you see H, you see the strain of the gravitational wave in units of minus 21. So this is one. So the peak is 10 to the minus 21. If you multiply by the length of the arms, it means 4 times 10 to minus 18 meters. And this is are roughly the data, the raw data, the data coming directly from the detector. There is only a pass band in the data just to cut the low frequency, the high frequency, which are not interesting. So you see the chirp. If you superpose the signal in Livingston to the signal in Hanford, you shift it by 7 milliseconds, you obtain the same signal. 7 milliseconds is the travel time between the two sides. If the signal was coming from one side, the exact travel time is 10 milliseconds. Actually, the signal is not coming exactly from one side, it's coming a little bit from the bottom. And you see here what we call a spectrogram. So this is the time, this is the frequency, and you see that in 200 milliseconds, the signal sweeps from 30, 40 hertz to 250 hertz. And we can hear the signal. So what we hear is the noise of the detector, and at the end we hear a little whoop whoop, and that's the signal. So it's the first sound is something. The first is the real frequencies. The second is higher frequency just to hear better the sound of the event. So it was clear, so the event was detected at 11:41. At 11:44, the first pipeline, fast pipeline, is called low latency fast pipeline, so 3 minutes after, detected the event. There are low frequency, low latency pipelines because what we want to do, we want to send the information of possible gravitational wave candidates to astronomers. In order to point telescopes to make electromagnetic follow-up of the events. From September to September 14 to February 11th, we worked to verification, many verification of the signal. So it took a few months to assess to completely understand that it was a real event. But it was clear immediately that the event was done by the coalescence of two black holes. And you can see it, here you see the shape of the event when you clean it by the noise. And you see here in red the shape. In gray, the shape superposed to the numerical relativity. You see that the event is in perfect agreement with the numerical simulation containing Einstein equation when you put the parameters of the source. And if you look at the frequency of the event and the derivative of the frequency, you understand immediately that it is the coalescence of black holes. And that's because the frequency of the event and derivative, they give access immediately to the masses of the objects. And so you understand that it is a coalescence of two black holes of a mass of 30 solar masses each, roughly. And the amazing behavior of these sorts is that if you see in this plot, in green you see the speed, the velocity of the two objects, and in unit of c, in unit of the speed of light. And you see that in this region they are turning at 0.3, the speed of light. When they merge, they are turning up half of the speed of light. So there are two objects of 30 times the mass of the sun turning up at half of the speed of light. So this plot is just to show that it was not possible to see the event before, and it was because of the upgrade of the detectors that the event was detectable. You see the signal-to-noise ratio here. This is the redshift, the distance of the event. You see the event as visible in the first, in the initial LIGO and Virgo, and this is the event visible here. So you see the signal-to-noise ratio is above this line, which is considered the threshold for an event to be detectable. And this is a little bit technical, but is a plot which shows the statistical significance of the event. So we have analyzed 16 days of event and trying to understand if it was possible that by chance the noise of the instrument, in the two instruments, was similar to what we have observed. And you see the event here, and the background is here. For two different kind of searches, this search is a generic transient search, so there is no hypothesis of the nature of the event. There is no general relativity. You just look for something exceeding the noise. And in this search, there is the general relativity. So you put theoretical waveforms of the coalescence of two black holes for different masses. So you put templates and you multiply the templates with the signal. And the two searches give the same result. The event is much higher than the background. So you can, from this plot, you can assess the false alarm probability of this event. And the false alarm probability is higher than 5 sigma, which correspond to a false alarm rate of one event over 200,000 years. So that's this number assess the confidence, the statistical significance of the event. So there is not only this plot is a kind of summary plot to assess the statistical significance. You have seen also that the green light, the reconstructed event from the data, is completely superposed to the red line, which is the numerical relativity. So the event has a false alarm rate very, very low, 1 over 200,000 years, and it is in complete agreement with the general relativity. And it is, of course, it is seen by the two interferometers at the distance of 3,000 kilometers each other. These are the source parameters. So these are the masses of the two black holes, 36 and 29. It's interesting to see the errors on the mass, which is very, very low. And this is due to the fact that the masses are completely determined by by the frequency and the derivative of frequency. So we don't observe a flux here. We observe a wave, we observe a field, we observe the phase of the field. And this is, gives access immediately a lot of information. And the distance is 400 megaparsecs, roughly 1,300,000,000 light years. And there is a bigger error on the distance because there is a degeneracy between the distance and the inclination of the orbit of the source. And we don't have this information since we have only two detectors for the moment. So this corresponds to a redshift. If you put some standard cosmology, you can convert this number in redshift, which is 0.1 redshift. So it's interesting to see that if you sum these two masses, you don't obtain the mass of the final black hole. And this because we have lost energy in gravitational waves. And we have lost roughly 3 solar masses in gravitational waves, which correspond to this to this incredible number of luminosity. And so this event is the most powerful event in the universe, and is 50 times the luminosity, the power of this event is 50 times the luminosity of the entire universe in electromagnetic waves. So it's a very powerful event. So the detection of this this event gave immediately some interesting test of the general relativity. General relativity has been tested in what we call the weak field or the medium weak field. So where the gravitational field is weak, and the speed of the objects are low compared with the speed of light. There are two main kind of tests which I've done. There are the tests done in the solar system, and also the tests done with the binary pulsars, like the Hals and Taylor pulsars. And for the first time, this detection is a test in what we call the strong field. In a system which speeds near the speed of light and with the fields very, very gravitational field very, very strong. And we made some test of consistency of the general relativity, and all these tests are in perfect agreement with general relativity. So it's a very important test of the general relativity. Is still valid in these extreme conditions. And there are also some work on the astrophysical implication on the origin of this event and of the rate of events like this one. So the coalescence of two black holes with 30 solar masses. So there are already some interesting results from the point of view of the fundamental physics and astrophysics. So let me conclude, first of all, an outlook. So what we happen now? So there are 4 months of data taken from September to January. Only a fraction of this data have been analyzed. Now the LIGO and Virgo collaboration analyzing the second part of the data. In roughly 3 months there will be an update of the results of the second part of the data. And then the Virgo interferometer is under integration. The integration will be completed probably in April, and we hope to operate the detector at the end of this year. There will be other science runs, other data takings, so in collaboration with LIGO at the end of the year. Then Kagra, the Japanese Kagra interferometer, which is very interesting, is an underground interferometer in the Kamioka mine, is the mine where this experiment, Super Kamiokande, which led to the last Nobel Prize, which is under construction. And just after the discovery, the Indian Prime Minister approved the construction of another LIGO detector in India, where the LIGO project gives the instrument, and the Indian government gives the ground and the pipe, the infrastructure. So this will be the networks of gravitational wave detector in the next years. And it's very important to have a network of several detectors, because you can understand much more about the source. You can understand the position in the sky, which very good precision, and you can understand also some properties of the gravitational waves. For example, you can infer if the gravitational waves have two polarization or more, as it is expected by alternative theories with respect to the general relativity. So this is what we call the sky map of the event. So in this picture, we represent the whole sky. And in this region, there is the most probable direction for the event. This region is very big. It's so big because there are only two detectors. And with only two detectors, you cannot identify a point in the sky, but a circle. But since the two detectors, you can also measure the amplitude of the wave, and two detectors, the circle, you can do a little bit better than a circle. You can do this kind of shape. This shape is very big, is of the order of 600 square degrees, which corresponds to roughly 3,000 full moons. So it's a very big big region of the sky. It's 1% of the sky. So if Virgo was present, when Virgo will be present, this region will be reduced by a factor of 100. So electromagnetic telescope can be pointed in a much smaller region, and we hope to have other information, for example, an electromagnetic counterpart. So what will happen after? So the initial detector are here, 2010. We give one to their sensitivity. Now we are a sensitivity of 3, 2015. The design of LIGO and Virgo have a sensitivity of 10. And then there are already planned upgrade for the advanced detector with sensitivity of 30. And the third generation detectors, which are under study, have a sensitivity of 100 with respect to the initial detector. Every time we increase the sensitivity, we increase the rate of the events by the cube of the sensitivity. This is a picture of the Einstein telescope detector, which is under study, which would be a triangular underground detector with arms of 10 kilometers. So, there are the gravitational waves have a wide spectrum, like the electromagnetic waves. We are here under the Earth, Virgo and LIGO, but there are objects emitting also at lower frequency. There are projects in space, like LISA. It's a ESA project, which currently is planned for 2034. It's an interferometer with the arms of 1 million kilometers. And this can give access to the region around the milliards. So in the region around the milliards, there are black holes, there are coalescence of black holes, for example. Coalescence of black holes much more massive than the black holes we can see with the Virgo and LIGO. And there are other experiments to measure gravitational waves at much lower frequency, for example, pulsar timing experiment, And there is also the experiment measuring the polarization of the cosmic microwave background, like the BICEP experiment you probably know. And this just last news, for example, the technology demonstrator for the space project LISA has been launched in December 2015, and the test masses have been released February 16, and so we will have some science data very soon. This is a technology demonstrator for LISA, so it's not able to detect gravitational waves, but it's a very important step to build this space project. So that's the summary. So the gravitational waves has been predicted by Einstein 100 years ago. There is this observation made by LIGO and published by the LIGO and Virgo collaboration, who analyzed the data together. This is the first direct detection of gravitational waves, the first observation of a merger of binary black hole. It represents the first test of the gravity in the strong field regime. It's the first observation of stellar mass black holes heavier than 25 solar masses. So there are a lot of discoveries there. And there is a main paper plus 12 companion papers which will be published soon. I think one or two papers are already published with details on the analysis and on the astrophysical interpretations of this observation. So let me conclude saying that in the 17th century, Galileo first observed the moon of Jupiter with the first telescope, the first astronomical object, and after 400 years, we gave birth to the new kind of astronomy, the gravitational astronomy. We have already a demonstration of the capabilities of this astronomy for the first observation of black hole merger. Thank you for your attention.